Let me start the recording. So friends, what are we going to discuss today, right? So yesterday we got different calls from saying that, sir, before we start working on what is installation of R and what are the things with that, right? So we just wanted to understand, like, so what is statistics? What is machine learning? And then what is AI and what is deep learning, right? Because there is a little overlapping among all these fields. So it's better, let's try to clarify those, some of those basic things, right? So as part of today's session, what we're going to discuss is what is statistics, then what is statistical modeling, then what is machine learning, what is an overlap between statistics and machine learning, then again in the similar way there's a deep learning. Now deep learning comes as part of the machine learning. Now we will try to understand what is the difference between machine learning and deep learning, and everyone aims to become an AI engineer. Now how does this machine learning or how does this deep learning will try to help you as a long term to become an AI engineer? And also we are going to touch base about what is natural language processing too. So we'll quickly touch base upon what are the different sciences that you're going to learn as part of this program, and a brief introduction about what are all these things. To starting with, right, we will be starting the subject from what is statistics. So friends, have you ever thought about what is statistics? Or else let me ask this question: are we using any statistical measures as part of our day-to-day life? Anyone?
Yes.
Are we? Yes. Can you give me an example, Mahesh?
Like if we have fever, we will see the temperature daily, right? That's
okay.
A simple example. Yeah.
Okay. Temperature is just a factor which is having some value, right? I don't see any statistical techniques, or maybe I don't see any statistical measures are being used. Okay.
Corona cases based on countries. That's one of the statistics.
Yeah.
Okay. Maybe the percentage of growth, maybe the number of cases that is getting increased, right? Yeah. Definitely, yeah. Those are making sense. But that is not a day-to-day life, isn't it? Once in a while, a bad pandemic which has hit the world.
But stock market shares and everything.
Weather condition shares.
Okay, weather condition is one of the common things that we always ask. Since this is a monsoon in India, definitely we are worried about, hey, will it rain tomorrow or not, right? So these are some of those things that we can always say where we talk about the predictions. But even before we talk about such kind of and forecasting things, we are using statistics, right? Even a non-techie guy, even a person who is leading his normal life somewhere else will be using some statistics techniques. How? So as an example, what is an average number of hours you sleep, right? That is a very common question, right? I said, hey, I need an average of 8 hours per day, else I'll feel headache or drowsiness when I get up in the morning, right? What is an average expenditure, or what is the minimum expenditure that your household will need, right? So do you think that these are some of those external things, or these are some of the things that we need as part of a day-to-day basis?
Day-to-day.
Means knowingly or unknowingly, we have been using some statistical measures as part of our day-to-day life. We didn't even know whether I'm using the minimum, when I'm using the maximum, when I'm using the mean values. We never bothered about whether they are from which branch of science. So that's how your statistics and basic mathematical measures, right, have been used very widely in our day-to-day lives. And very common, some of the common question now, due to the lockdown, we are not able to step into our office, but we generally ask the moment we find, hey, I'm from Miapur, okay, how long does it take, what is an average time that it takes to reach from your home to office? Isn't it, friends? It's a common question the moment you start going to the workplace, right? So this is how all your basic mathematical and statistical measures have been used very widely in your day-to-day lives. Right, so the reason statistics is irreplaceable, right? So even though you are not going to do or work as a data scientist, to certain extent these things present around us without even we are realizing we are using them, which are the basic and core functionality of your statistical subjects. So the reason, now let's try to define what is statistics. Anyone has an idea, a brief idea, what does statistics deal with?
A representation of collected data.
Excellent, right? So she was able to nail the first and last phase of her statistics. So statistics always is a science which is concerned with developing and also studying the methods, which always revolves around four. It talks about collection of the data. As soon as you collect the data, right, we definitely need to analyze the data. And once you analyze the data using the different ways, right, you need to interpret the results, right? Based upon your problem statement, I wanted to interpret the results, whether it could be a simple reactive approach or else it could be a predictive in nature, right? And finally, presenting this data is very, very important. So because we always be from a technology background, we always think that as soon as I am done with my solution, right, I'm good to go to the next project. Friends, again, this is a data science subject. How good the solution might be if you are not able to convincingly present your solution to the business teams, because business does not understand technology. Business teams does not understand the mathematical statistical models or how hard you took your 3 to 4 months of time to develop a solution. It is all about whether I was able to understand which I'm using it. So that's how the business mindset would be. So ultimately, how good the solution might be, it is all about the presenting the data. Agree? So this is how we need to be very careful on the last step, right? Because recently I don't want to take a name, but there was one of my teammates, right? He was like 8 years of experience. He's very techie guy. He works very aggressively and he tries to complete the project well within the time. But again, right, as I said, data science jobs are the individual contributors. Even though you'll have it people of 6 or 10, each will try to work on their own individual projects. Major until unless is a very complex where data science want to share the data, but most of the times it is all about single person driving the project. Other persons can pitch in and help, that's it. But it would not be generally like your technology teams where you don't even bother and other can code for you. But this is not a coding subject, it is an understanding of the data, then trying to implement in coding. So the reason a person who is at the start of the project would be the only person who would be able to understand, give a better solution. Other people can come in handy, but data science are mostly individual contributor roles. Okay, so that is what happens if you're not able to tell the story by yourself, right? All your hard work which you have done for the last several months will go in vain, as simple as it is, right? So he has developed an excellent solution which is very statistically intensive, right? But he was not able to present in a convincing way. So being in principal data scientist, I have to pitch in and I try to help him, but that's how it happens. So you have gone through the first three phases successfully, but the moment it comes to demo, the moment it comes to walk through the solution to get a business approval, if that does not go well, it will take multiple iterations. It will further delay the project. It is not just the accuracy that you throw onto your dashboards. Hey, I got 99.5% accuracy, please approve. No. So business would always be interested to know how things works, and whether it was able to handle all the different scenarios or not. Is it really possible to replace the existing manual work with an intelligent automation that you have created? So they look at the different dimensions because they are the owners of the particular process. And if something goes wrong, they are the ones who will get impacted more. Okay. So the reason while we have more emphasis on developing the solution, but we generally don't neglect the presentation part of it. Okay, when I say presentation, again, don't think we have to do out of the box, but it is the way you have traveled the journey, you need to explain to a non-technical person. Are you clear? Is everyone clear about what is statistics? Collection, analysis, interpretation, and finally, presenting the data. Are you clear now, friends? Any questions? As I said, I appreciate your responses either in the chat or through voice. I just got two.
Good, Danish.
And finally, you are presenting the data. Okay, so this is what we do with statistics, right? As I said, we have been using statistics in our day-to-day lives, where we always mostly minimum, maximum, average. These are the very common statistical measures that we always be worried about. What is the average time taken to go to office from home? Or what is an minimum expenditure that will happen in your household, right? So these are how these different things will be used as part of this. Now let's try to take an interesting application, right? Now we'll try to see how statistics has been applied historically. Right. Okay. Let me ask this question. So as soon as you wake up right? What is the first product? Okay, please don't say it's a cell phone. What is the daily essential product that you pick for your daily activities or the morning activities?
Clock.
Okay, daily essential that you use.
Mobile.
Okay, clock. As I said, right, except mobile, please. Friends?
Toothpaste.
Simple, toothpaste. Okay. Now let me try to tell you how this statistical or machine learning is going to help you right from the formulation lab till it gets your house. Okay, let's try to track the journey of a toothpaste, right? And how it gets manufactured. Right, what happens behind the scenes until it reaches your house. Now let's try to see the application of your analytics. When I say analytics, the both the combination of statistics and machine learning and how they're going to help us. Okay, now let's try to say what is the first stage of manufacturing your product, friends?
Raw materials collect.
Okay, again, that way I'm going to talk about very high level, because the moment we talk about the granular level, then there are hundreds of steps. To keep it very simple, it is all about formulation, right? First, I need to have a good formula. Only then my organization can definitely have something on it. Agree? Only then they will be able to factor. So the first step would be to formulate formulation. So the reason what we say, the application, as I said, is a simple toothpaste example. The reason I'm trying to take the simple product is just wanted to emphasize, like, for anything to get to your market and to get your household, it involves a lot of stages, and at every stage the application of statistical modeling was already there. Okay, now the first phase is formulation. So what is a formulation? Because it is a toothpaste, so definitely it has n number of ingredients, and one of those most primary ingredients is fluoride, right? I think we have learned this aspect of our high schools, I think, right? The impact of fluoride, right? If you try to keep it a more quantity, definitely it will affect the safety of it. Agree? Because there is a parts per million that you need to maintain the moment you put a fluoride content into your toothpaste. At the same time, if you are over cautious and if you are using very less, what will happen?
It will not be effective.
Excellent. It will not be effective. It means the more I put, it is a safety concern. If I put very less, then it then will not be effective as expected. So the reason you use a lot of statistical techniques and statistical modelings to ensure there is safety and at the same time there is some effectiveness. It means it is a trade-off, or it's a balanced approach between the safety concerns versus effectiveness, right? Here we are using the statistical effectiveness to ensure there is safety, and at the same time there is a concept of effectiveness of my product. Is everyone clear on this? Again, first, we are not going to deal completely. I just wanted to say, for a simple product called as toothpaste, you never even assumed saying that there is involvement of statistics at various phases. That is my objective to take this as an example. Okay, now once formulation is done, what do we do? The formula is ready. The scientist has told that yes, this is formula, and they have
manufacturing.
Excellent. It is all about productionization. It is all about manufacturing that particular product. Now in production, what happens? Because production is being generally dealt by your machines, right? Most of the times these days everything is automated, isn't it, friends? Except for a few manual things, most of the things are manufactured by the gigantic machines, right? But since those are machines, can you always expect, right, it would be of the same quality and of the same consistency?
No, obviously no.
Probably no. So the reason we use statistics again for the quality control, right? Why? To bring in the consistency, right? Because they are machines, they are bound to error, right? So this is what we do. We always take some random sampling from every lot, right? Because these products are generally created in lots. This is a common terminology that they use, and in every lot they do take some random sampling. They try to do some hypothesis testing on it to ensure that the quality of this particular product will still remain the same irrespective of the month of the year, irrespective of the week of the month, or irrespective of the day of the week, or else irrespective of the hour of the day. a product which is getting manufactured at 10 a.m. IST should be the same when it gets manufactured at 5 p.m. Okay, so this is how the statistical models or statistical analysis have been used historically to ensure there is a quality and the consistency in the product manufacturing. Okay.
Yes,
are you clear on this?
Yeah.
Okay. Just give me a second. Okay. Now, once the production is being done, what do we do? Now, the a particular company has been able to manufacture it. Now, when they're trying to manufacture, they need to always think about pricing, isn't it? Because there are n number of products already in the market who are your competitors. Now, how do you best optimize the price? In order to save or in order to save some cost, what is the best strategy to package, right? And also, what should be the marketing expenditure that you need to do? Isn't it, friends? Once the product is available, so these are the common, some of the common things that you always be worried about being in a manufacturing sector. Agree? What is the better price, right? Because there are 10 products which are all the way from, as an example, for 50 grams all the way to 20 rupees to 80 rupees. Now you need to identify what is the best price that you can keep, right? Along considering all your cost that you were able to incur as part of this product manufacturing, over and above what is the revenue, what is an profit margin that you're going to have it. Again, when you try to consider all these factors, again, it results in a statistical model, right? And again, how do I package them, right? And also, how do I market them, right? Again, marketing is one of the crucial aspects. How good your product might be, if you're not able to devise a good marketing strategy, right? It is seldom waste. Agree or not? So these days, marketing is the only thing that can make your product or mar your product. Agree? So evaluating, looking at different factors, you need to optimize a lot of your strategies. The moment you look about optimization, again, you are going to make use of statistical techniques to optimize these values. Okay. And again, the sales, right? This is a very common aspect, right? The moment you talk about you are done with the formula, you are able to manufacture the product, now you are able to identify the best pricing strategy, the packaging strategy, and the marketing strategy, it is all about predicting or understanding your locations where you can be able to sell this, right? So just like, right, if you have a luxury credit card, would you be able to target the people who are just passed out of your college students? Can you target them?
No.
So it means you need to identify the horizon. How do you want it to increase your sales based upon a particular location or based upon a demographic characteristics? You look at all those dimensions. The moment again you are trying to talk about segmentation and etc. and again forecasting of your sales, again the statistical techniques gets involved. Okay. So once say that you are able to figure it out all this, but how does a product which is getting manufactured at Gurgaon facility should be able to reach Hyderabad? Right, because as you know, all organizations or all manufacturing companies do not sell directly to retail. Do they, friends? Do they directly sell door to door?
No.
Definitely not. So they have a national level distribution, state level distributors, district level distributors, and it has to reach to your market stores. So what do? They need to identify how many products should they manufacture. So we generally call them as supply chain management. Some of those very, very important concept. The moment you are into the manufacturing industry, I don't know how many of you are from having an association with respect to this product called manufacturing, but the moment you are there, these are very good field where you can implement a lot of statistical techniques, demand and supply. And based upon this, how much a supply chain should I maintain, right? At a state level, at a distributor level, right? So that they should not run out of the stock. As you know, right, the moment you run out of the stock, you are missing a chance to sell products to the customers. It means customers are getting associated from other products. The moment if it is better than you, then you have lost a customer. So the reason ensuring a good supply of your products at all levels is very, very important. Agree?
Yeah.
Right. So the reason again, I'm making use of my statistical knowledge here to understand the demand, to understand the supply. Right, where should be sale, right? The moment I have to supply at a particular Spencer supermarket in Hyderabad. So I should have released my products starting from Gurgaon facility at least 1 month back. Right? It has to cross through, it has to reach the distributor. The distributor has to supply to a local, and the local distributor has to supply to them. So there are a lot of things that goes in which are at a multiple touch points. Right? So the reason we always try to see, we are ensuring a constant supply of the products to all the retail stores. Now, friends, are we done, or do you think that there is still something left out? So the product has at last reached out to your near house, Kirana store, or maybe it could be a grocery store, or it could be a supermarket. What do you do after this?
Support, if any.
Okay. So before we do, so have you ever walked out about any of those IKEAs or any of those MNC supermarkets? Do you see that the products are placed in a shelf in a particular way? Have you ever seen this?
The
products are nicely arranged. And is it the same time that every time you walk in?
It's kind of promotion.
According to the price and at the eye level, they are arranged in different ways, maybe at the different timings. Busy hours, they do it in different ways.
Have you ever thought that there would be an algorithm that is running behind the scenes? How many of you are aware of this, friends? All the products which are placed in a shelf, right? There is an algorithm that runs behind the scenes, which is capturing the latest purchasing behaviors, right? Now, I'm not saying that every Tom, Dick and Harry store will try to do it, but all those MNCs which are backed by good technology power, right? They are trying to do this. So the shelf placements, it means even the placement of the products in different shelves, right? What are the products that should stay near to each other, right? There is a science behind it, right? The algorithm name is called as affinity analysis, right? Which we are going to discuss as part of our program too. Right, even the placement of the products in a shelf is being designed and is being driven or is being led by a statistical model. And as again I'm saying, this is not every Indian store is trying to do, but when you go to Costco, when you go to Walmart, when you go to all those big MNC, right, they are the ones, I think Target is the first one who has implemented this, right? The classic example is generally called as beer diaper example. Right, because in the US it's a very common practice to drink, right? So drinking beer is like just like drinking the water over there. So when a newborn arrives at a home, right, so the moment it's the father's responsibility to get all those groceries, till the other point of night is mostly the woman who takes care of them. The moment the child comes, right, so it's, we are no different, so we have to take care of all the external activities so that mother can stay with the baby. So this is what happened, right? So whenever the men are trying to buy the diapers, they are also trying to buy the beers. So this was one as a classical example that we always say, like whenever someone is trying to discuss affinity analysis, they always try to take this a classical example, right? Beer diaper example. Okay, people, whenever they're trying to buy the diapers, they try to buy something for themselves too, and this pattern always occurred in nearly 90% of the cases when Target was trying to gel through this particular pattern recognitions. Okay, are you clear now? So right from the formulation, we have till able to reach the retail stores and the placement of the products and the shelves. Now once this is done, what do you do? You go in, you try to purchase the product, you put it into the cart, and you go for the billing, right? Either you use a debit card, you use a credit card, or some XYZ cards. Again, there is a role of statistics. How?
Payment method.
Can you come again?
It's a payment method, you're saying?
It's not about payment method, because the moment you try to swipe it, what happens in the behind scenes? All your financial organizations or payment gateways, right? They go for fraud check or not fraud checks, right? It happens in a blink of a second. It means it happens in a microseconds. Right, so that's how you'll be able to use some of the statistical techniques to ensure whether this is a regular pattern or a not a regular pattern. Right, the moment you try to do some high value transactions, I think I'm not sure, but if you are right, you might be getting some calls or you might be getting some kind of a message saying, hey, is this the one who has done this transaction? Right, how this happens, again, there is this behavioral pattern analysis that happens behind the scenes on your transactions. What was your historical transaction amount, the count, the place, etc. The moment they see a weird transaction, now all those, some of those banking organizations, now they're trying to implement the fraud in real time, but not on the batch process. Okay, so that's how even there is an application of statistics to this extent. Okay, are you clear on this? And even once the transactional history has been recorded, you are getting a lot of good recommendations. How? Again, they are trying to understand the customer purchasing behavioral patterns. Again, there is a role of statistics. Friends, how is it looking like? We just started with one of those daily essential products called toothpaste, and we just very high level. It's a very high level that we have listed on what are the different phases. And do you see a role of analytics, stats, or machine learning in every phase?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So this is how your statistics is not a theoretical subject which is sitting in the books, but it is a field of science which is actually getting implemented or applicable across different industries, across different domains. So if people ask, sir, where can you apply statistics? I would definitely say all the domains, all the industries, whether it could be an insurance, whether it could be an e-commerce platform, or it could be any medical research, right? Or it could be any banking, any financial organization, it could be telecom, it could be pharma. The list just goes on. There's no end to it, right? The moment you have the data, the moment you have some kind of an insight that you would like to bring in, the application of statistical or analytics is there. Are you clear on this point? And so on. Are you clear?
Yeah.
Okay, now we just touched about what is statistics in a very brief way. Now let's try to understand what is statistical modeling then, right? Because the moment I'm trying to talk about, there are statistical models. So let's try to understand what is a statistical modeling means. So simply, right, so most of the cases when you're working on real-time projects as a data scientist, it is all about understanding the relationship between the inputs and outputs in the data. Okay, we do more than this, but most of the cases. So the reason your statistical modeling is defined, it is a formulation of relationships between the input variables and output variables present in the data in the form of a mathematical equation. Because as you know, statistics is a subject, is a branch that has originated from the field of mathematics. So it means mathematics is a high level and the statistics is a branch of mathematics. So the reason whenever you wanted to understand the relationship between the variables present in the data, you always choose a mathematical equation. Okay, are you clear on this point, friends? What is statistical modeling? It is a formulation of relationships between the variables present in the data in the form of mathematical equation, period. It means the moment you are trying to talk about statistics, you are always making use of mathematical approach only. Are you clear on this point?
Yeah, sounds good.
Right, so there you need to understand, saying that statistics has descriptive and inferentials, and over and above it, you have some statistical models which is trying to formulate the relationships in the data in the form of mathematical equations. Okay, so that is the concept that goes behind. It means no matter what you do, the moment you're trying to talk about a statistical approach, it will get involved the mathematical equation. Without an equation, you cannot escape from a statistical approach. Are you clear? Why? The simple reason is it is originated from the branch of mathematics. So the reason it is heavily been, it is not heavily, it is entirely dependent on your mathematical approach. So the reason the moment you look at statistical formulas and etc., you will see sigmas, you will see differentiations, you will see integrations, proofs, etc. Why? Because you have taken a mathematical approach to solve a particular problem, right? Some of those common examples that you always see is we talk about regressions, right? A regression is a very common statistical model that we tend to use it, right? Your decision trees. Right, so these are some of the common statistical models. Again, friends, if you have seen our course content, we included this regression, we included this decision trees as part of your machine learning algorithm. But if you go to the granular extent, those are nothing but your statistical models. So that's how your statistical subject and machine learning are getting overlapped a lot, right? Because as long as I'm trying to solve the problem, I need not worry whether I'm using a statistical method or a machine learning method. So there is in most of the cases, now we are interchangeably using the statistical terminology with machine learning terminology. Okay, and a simple example, how does this look like? Say Y. Y is nothing but the output that you would like to estimate, that you would like to predict, right? Can be explained by this, right? This is how a mathematical approach would look like for one of the algorithms. Okay, what does Y mean? Y is an outcome variable that you would like to predict. And what does X1, X2? Those are nothing but some of those input factors which are influencing the outcome. And beta naught, B1, B2, those are nothing but the weights that you will calculate using some mathematical procedures. So this is how we are trying to formulate the relationships among the variables. X1, X2 are the input variables and Y is an outcome that you are going to build. And how we're going to build it? This is a simple example of one of the mathematical approach to solve a given problem. Are you clear on this? Any questions?
None at this
point. How about others? Geetika, I'm not getting any reply from you.
I'm
clear.
Yeah, I'm clear.
Okay, now coming to the machine, then what is machine learning? If statistical modeling is going to help me in getting the relationship between inputs and outputs, then what is the need of machine learning? So machine learning is a science that is originated from the branch of computer science. The moment we say computer science, do we need to only concern about mathematics, friends? Do we need to only consider mathematics? What are your thoughts? Definitely we have exposed to some computer engineering by now, isn't it? When you're trying to talk about computer science engineering, are we concerned only about mathematics?
It also involves coding.
Yes, it is very important, because when someone is trying to deal with computer science, it's all about developing a step-by-step approach to solve a problem. So then we say, whenever we are trying to talk about machine learning, we always say, hey, have you used an algo? I've used a particular algorithm. Why? Because algorithm is nothing but a step-by-step procedure to solve a problem. But whereas we are starting, it's very rigid. He says, hey, I use only mathematics to understand the relationship between inputs and outputs. When it comes to machine learning, he says, I'm very liberal. I'm very secular. I mean to say that I can use any technique or any procedure as long as I'm learning from the data. Right, I'm not going to use if conditions, I'm not going to use any if else conditions or the business rules, but I'm going to solve your problem by understanding the data. And how do I solve the problem? I will try to generate an algorithm. So this particular algorithm can be dependent on your mathematics, can be dependent on your some economical concepts, it could be dependent upon anything, no matter I know, because it is a step-by-step procedure to solve a problem that can learn from the data without relying on any rules-based programming. It means I'm not going to write any if conditions here to learn from the data, but I'm going to tell my machine, or I will try to empower my machine by giving an algorithm which will try to help to learn from the data. Are clear on this point, friends? Again, we are going to discuss integrated data, but for now, a one-liner definition about what does machine learning deal with. Okay? Any questions?
All good.
Okay, so then we say it is been originated from the branch of computer science. So the reason the approach is not being restricted to make just use of mathematical approach, it can use anything. So there is one of the very classical example that we can talk about a machine learning is random forest. Now friends, to keep it very simple, what is forest made up of?
Trees and
where do you see the trees in statistical modeling? It means it is using the decision trees, which is a statistical technique, and it's going to apply the things in a very different way. Because we, if you remember it, there's a bootstrap algorithm that are available. It means it's using a bootstrapping algorithm on decision trees, which is a statistical model. It means the underlying foundational block for machine learning algorithm for this example is decision trees. But the way I'm using the decision trees is completely different, right? So this is what happens. It means machine learning can lift some of the topics from different sciences and will come up with its own approach to solve our problem. Are you clear? Are we clear on this? But again, don't get confused,
yeah,
because we'll be learning regression. We have been learning decision trees as a machine learning algorithm itself. But if you wanted to go to a granular level, those are the statistical models. Those are not your machine learning algorithms. But again, being an applied data scientist, we need not be bothered about whether it's in statistical model or machine learning model. You get this point? Are you clear?
Yeah.
Right? So the reason we always say your machine learning, right, is a glorified statistics. Why? Because it is using this most of the concept that is already been defined, but it is trying to enhance a little and trying to solve the problems. Because the object is one and the same. What is an object of both the subjects? The objective of the both the sciences is one and the same. Well, how do we learn from the data? Is it not doing the same thing, friends? Agree? How do we learn from the data? So the reason we say machine learning is a glorified statistics, right? Most of the concepts that you're going to learn on machine learning somewhere is getting dependent on your basic statistical or mathematical techniques. Okay, are you clear on this?
Ganesh, this is Pranati. Can you elaborate more on random forest? I didn't understand the bootstrap.
Okay, see, random forest itself will take 2 days of time to explain. But if you want me to explain in one line of statements, decision tree is a statistical technique. I'm using combination of these decision trees using another algorithm called bootstrapping. By combining the bootstrapping plus tens of decision trees, I can create a new algorithm called as random forest.
Okay.
Do you got the point? It means the underlying concept that I wanted to explain is most of the machine learning algorithms or been an enhancement of what has been already existing in your statistical subject. Clear on this? Friends, are we clear?
Yes.
Okay. Now we got an understanding about what is statistics, what is statistical modeling, what is machine learning. Now, what is the next piece? Deep learning. Now, where does this deep learning come into the picture? Right? So, friends, deep learning is nothing but, right, it is a subset of your machine learning, but it uses the neural networks to simulate human-like kind decision making. As you know, right, what is the most intelligent species on the planet called Earth?
Brain.
Human.
Humans. Right. But why humans are most intelligent?
They are having the capability of thinking.
Yeah, they have the capability of thinking, but how does thinking come in? So when you go to this particular in-depth analysis, right, it is all about your super intellectual brain. And in brain, a normal human, right, adult brain has around 85 billion neurons. Wow, is it not fascinating, friends? Our human brain, which is a simple mass of a fist, right, it is having 85 billion neurons. Now, because of this, 85 billion neurons are talking to each other, are interconnected. Our computation power, our storage power, our intellectual power is of next level, right? But when you compare the same to a cat, it would be running into millions. If you go down a little, a rat, it will go further down. If you go a little down, a cockroach, it will not be lasting more than 10 lakhs. And if you go a little down, maybe a fly, it will have hardly 1 lakh neurons, right? It means the intelligence of a particular species is majorly dependent upon the neural networks. So what happens? So our scientists have been spending a lot of years, right from 1970s, they have done extensive research on how do you simulate a human brain artificially. So that's where they have came up with a concept called as neural networks. What do you mean neural networks? Just like a biological neuron tries to process the information, this particular artificial neuron will also try to simulate the similar human kind of behavior. Okay, are you clear now? A artificial neuron tries to simulate the biological neuron processing. Okay, so that's the reason we say artificial neural networks. Now, a artificial neural network without an architecture might not be able to solve a lot of complex problem statements, right? Just like your face recognitions, maybe a self-driving cars, or maybe a autonomous flying robot, or maybe a humanoid robot called as Sophia, right? Or else you wanted to beat Vishwanath Anand in his own chess game, right? So there are a lot of complexities which needs to be resolved. Only a superhuman intelligence can do it, right? So the reason this is a science, we always say your deep learning is a subset of your machine learning. It means you are going to learn artificial neural network as part of your machine learning subject. That is just one piece of it. That is a foundational block that you're going to learn. But if you wanted to get a better hold on solving some of those complex problem statements, you need to be an expert at deep learning. So the reason we say your deep learning is a subset of your machine learning, okay, which uses neural networks to simulate human-like decision making. Are you clear on this point? Okay. Again, there is a subject, a separate module on this, but on a one-line statement, if you wanted to see, your deep learning is a subset of your machine learning, and your machine learning is a subset of your AI. What is AI? AI is nothing but artificial intelligence. The moment you simulate a human behavior, you can label a system, a process, a program, a service as an AI. Okay, don't ever think that AI is all about making a robot walk. Yes, that is an ultimate state of a AI. But all the things which are going to replace a human activity can be considered as an AI, but those are on the low level. Okay, so there will be more emphasis more on the machine learning, because you're learning or you are using the experience that is generated from the data to solve a particular problem. But so then we say machine learning is a subset of an AI which tries to be working upon an algorithm that can learn from the data. And whereas deep learning, no, deep learning is a subset of your machine learning, where it uses neural networks as an approach, neural networks as a foundational concept to build some complex architectures to solve some of those hard to not crack problem statements. Are you clear on this now, friends? What is statistics, statistical modeling, machine learning, deep learning, and its relation with respect to your AI? The simple diagram which tries to help you in getting a better understanding of them. Okay. So your ultimate goal should always be become an AI engineer, but the starting step would always to become a data scientist, which uses your statistics, statistical modeling, machine learning, deep learning, NLP to solve some of those common problems. Once you are able to do, you can put a long-term solution saying that, hey, I wanted to work on a specific piece of AI. Okay, are you clear? Any questions?
So NLP is part of AI, I understand that, but where does it fall in that picture?
Very good, that's what I'm going to explain now. Now what is NLP? So most of the times in real time, right, working for an enterprise, right, historically, we have been storing a lot of structured data. What do you mean by structured data? It is a combination of your rows and columns. The moment the data can be fitted into rows and columns, right, we can generally call them as a structured data, right? It has a fixed schema that you can store the information. But when it comes to some of the other information, can you always expect the data to be structured? Can we?
No.
Definitely not, right? The email data that we use internally, right, the chat messages that we use internally, or is the documents where the customer tries to fill in some forms, right, the document that you try to share your knowledge to other teammates, right, there are a lot of forms where the structure of the data is getting changed. And one such kind of a common structure that you need to work on real time is text data. People would be getting fancied about audio recognitions, video analysis, etc. But friends, we are working as a technology person respect to insurance, telecom, retail, or banking or financial organizations, right, etc. So definitely we will not be getting a chance to do any face recognition as part of real time projects, right? You will see a lot of articles in YouTubes and different blogs and articles, but those are not problems that you're going to solve in your real time, right? And one of the most common unstructured information that we need to work on is text data. So it means this is a field of study that focuses on interactions between a human language and a computer. The moment you try to understand the human language using some machines, we generally call that particular field of study as NLP, which is nothing but natural language processing. Are you clear on this now? What is natural language processing? The natural language processing is a field of study that is trying to understand the interactions between a human language and a computer. Are clear now? What is NLP?
Yeah.
Right? So it means it comes as an intersection, right? If you wanted to sit, how does the NLP fit in? It fits in somewhere between computer science, artificial intelligence, and computational linguistics, because we are trying to deal with languages. The moment you try to talk about languages, there is a separate field called as linguistics, because you need to know, understand the parts of speech. You need to understand how the sentences are framed. And there are a lot of other intelligence that you need to gain from the language perspective. Agree? So the reason I would say that NLP sits somewhere between computer science, artificial intelligence, and computational linguistics. Are you clear now? So it means NLP is a way for your computers to analyze, understand, and derive meaning from human language. How do you derive? We have to use some smart and useful way to derive the insights from a text information. Right? So this is the moment to talk about NLP, you always talk about automatic summarization, right? Text classifications, named entity recognitions, sentiment analysis, right? Topic segmentation, chunking. So there are a lot of different terminology that gets involved based upon the problem statement that you're working on. But this particular field of study is always trying to focus on interactions between human language and computers. The moment you deal with human language, that field will become NLP. Now, are you clear now? Where does this fit in? It is an intersection point between AI, language, linguistics, and etc.
Yep.
Okay. So Geetika, to your question, right? What tool or framework we'll be using, right? We'll be using three frameworks, Geetika. We'll be using R, we'll be using Python, we'll be using TensorFlow. When it comes to NLP, we are going to make use of NLTK as a standard Python library. And depending upon this, right, maybe we will try to make use of some of those other libraries too. But NLTK would be the one that we'll be mostly using as part of your NLP subject. Okay.
Can you repeat the NLP stuff, please?
Can you come again, Geetika?
Can you please repeat what framework we would use for the NLP?
NLTK. NLTK is a library, basically, but we will be using the Python and we will be using the TensorFlow to apply some machine learning and deep learning models on the text informations. But if you're trying to talk about language, it is R, Python, and TensorFlow. And if you're trying to talk about the library that we are using for NLP modules, then it would be NLTK.
Okay, thank you.
So that's what I thought of sharing today. So any questions? So this is an open forum. So we are done with the all introduction sessions. So from tomorrow, it is all about getting the machines, right, upgraded with our software and start getting our hands dirty. Okay, so these are the three introduction sessions. I think most of the questions have been addressed as part of this, and based upon our each module, we are going to get into detailed analysis. But I thought these are some of the basic things that you need to be clear about, right? On the starting of the day, we thought about how that program structure would be there. So that's what we have discussed, where we have listed on what are all the things that you're going to get and etc. And the second day, that is yesterday, we focused more on why do we need so many subjects, right? How these subjects will help you in trying to cross each one of those phases of delivering a data science project successfully. And as part of today's session, we have just understood why do we need to learn all those skill sets? What do they do? What are the one-liner definitions? And some of the simple examples for you to get a brief overview about what does each one of those fields deal with.
Hey, Dinesh, Chandu here. A quick question. It's good. How would the structure be from tomorrow? What are you envisioning? Like, how are you going to run the classes?
This has already been covered, and that is the first topic that I took on.
No, I'm not talking about the topics or anything like that. What I'm asking you is, like, structure is, it's like you give us some theory, and then there will be a problem, we work on that. Is that how it's going to be?
Even that has been dealt here. So it would be a combination of sessions, and we'll be trying to conduct some random quiz, and at the same time we are going to give some assignments as a homework to deal with. It goes in hand in hand.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Yeah, Geetika, when it comes to data engineering, it's already a different topic, right? So if you have just paid attention to the yesterday's session, your data engineering comes towards the left. See, you are going to learn some, what you call, I would say, some cashew nuts, and we are going to compare ourselves with respect to some peanuts. The reason I told this is because doing a data engineering stuff is pretty easy, right? Either you'll have some predefined ETL frameworks, or else you can use any scripting language. It could be a Scalar, it could be a Java-based MapReducing, right, to convert the data. But it is a very monotonous job. So don't think that there would be any insight that you'll be generating. It is all about dumping the data from different sources, applying some rules on them, and trying to take it to a separate destination. So definitely I wouldn't say the moment you're trying to talk about analytics, engineering is all about, to keep it very simple, it's like a lift irrigation scheme. You lift the data from different sources, apply some logics, and try to dump it to a destination location. Okay, so the reason the data engineering is not the one a data scientist does. There is a specialized role who are expert in writing those scripts, working on multiple databases, right? Sometimes they might have to use a tool, or sometimes they have to custom develop the solution. Okay, are you clear?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah. So hope any other questions, friends, before we drop for the day. So from tomorrow, it would be our session. So the introduction sessions are completed now, and we'll be starting as part of the plan. The initial 2 weeks would be to get our hands dirty, so that when we are trying to teach the theory, we can be on top of the practical implementation, so that once the machine learning starts, it's all about learning an algorithm today and immediately implementing the next day. That's how the structure of the program would be. Any questions?
Do we have to install Aura on our own, or are you going to help us install it on our machines?
So just reiterating, right? Right from installation of the software, explaining you the data types, right? Helping you to understand the conditional handling, everything will be dealt as part of the class itself. Okay. So it means tomorrow, the first 15 to 20 minutes, we are going to set up the environment on your machines. Okay.
Are you going to use the same link tomorrow, or the link is going to change?
It's the same one. Okay, that's another good point. So it would be the same link. Okay, people have requested saying that some concerns. So okay, so we're going to maintain the same link. So as you have enrolled for the program, you'll get all the respective communication about accessing the videos, right? The videos have been already uploaded to the drive link. All the OneNote that I'm going to write here has been converted into PDF. Those have been uploaded. So everything would be getting uploaded by the end of the day. It would be done by 2 p.m., but just as a case, right, where I'm getting a little busy, it might take a little while to get them uploaded. But all the videos, all the content that will be going through the class has already been uploaded to the drive. Okay?
Okay.
Friends, any other questions? Okay. I take it as a no, and we're going to meet tomorrow. So please do maintain some time. People are joining a little late. The reason we are starting at 6:10 is to get you adjusted. 6 a.m. is a little hard time for a technologist, right, who is not an early bird. So the reason I'm just trying to wait for initial 5 to 10 minutes. But from Monday, we are going to maintain the sharp timings of 6:05 a.m. IST. Okay?
Sir, this is Pawan.
Yeah, Pawan.
In prior, we-